Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone. I'd like to welcome all of you back to Ohio Exopolitics. I'm your host, Mark Snyder. We're going to be talking about the Billy Meier case today. I thought I would step back, try to do a quick overview this afternoon. When Billy was 6 months old, he had a very bad pneumonia, slipped into a coma, and almost died. The contact reports and related information explained that he was saved by an extraterrestrial man named Svoth. Again, this occurred when Billy was just 6 months old. Svoth was a man from a star system called the Pleiaren star system, which is some 80 light years beyond our Pleiades. The Pleiades is some 400 light years away. The Pleiaren system is in what they call a different space and time configuration. Our universe has seven layers in it. The fourth layer of our universe is called the material belt, and within our material belt are all the stars, the galaxies, the solar systems. And those solar systems, that universe, that material aspect of our universe has different dimensions or different space-time configurations. The Meier information says there are seven different space-time configurations. I know this is a little bit hard to follow and makes for a rather confusing picture in some ways of our universes. But not only do these extraterrestrials travel great distances between the stars, but they also move between these different space-time configurations. And the Pleiaren visited the Earth in our very, very ancient past when they traveled into our solar system and into our space-time configuration. So, but these people, these Pleiarens, they're just human beings like us, but they're at a much higher level of evolution than we are. Most of their civilization is in the final stages of a completely physical existence. In other words, all human beings throughout our universe evolve through seven evolutionary steps. And the fifth stage is the final purely physical step of evolution. After that, we're kind of a half physical, half spiritual stage. And then the final stage, we're completely spiritual with no physical body. And we spend billions of years in that final stage of evolution. And then the Meier information says we merge back with creation. So what is creation? Creation is also known by the term universal consciousness. It's different than what our religions tell us. It's not a heavenly father. It's neither good nor evil, but it radiates love. In fact, love is the highest principle in all creation, which is somewhat difficult for us to wrap our mind around, in the sense that the universal superintelligence that's behind the evolution of our universe is evolving its own self. It doesn't have omniscience in the way we've been taught. It's learning. It's so much higher than the intellect of a human being, but yet it's still evolving and it's still learning. In fact, it's in the first stage of its evolution. And that's why we have material in our universe. And the Meier information explains that there are 10 to the 49th power other universes in something called the absolute absolutum. And only universes that are in their first stage of evolution have physical material belt. If you could look inside our universe, it's much like the rings on a tree stump. After you cut a tree down, you see these rings that are they're one inside the other, let's say, and they counter-rotate against one another, and there are different widths on these rings. And this is the physical structure of our universe, but we're talking trillions and trillions of light years of material. And I say material because really, truly, there's only material, physical matter in the fourth layer of these concentric circles, which are our creation. Matter is just compressed fine matter or compressed energy. So the whole idea of physical reality is different than what we think of it. Now, Billy, he had his first spiritual experience, let's just call that, when he was a very young boy, 4 years of age. And it's 3 a.m. one morning, and he wakes up and he crawls out a lower window in his bedroom and he looks up at a beautiful starry sky, and he says to himself things that seem to be coming from his
apologize. My Skype was dropped for whatever reason. I was talking about the Billy Meier case, and particularly Billy's first spiritual experiences that occurred on a mild night in May in 1941. And I was explaining that in our subconscious mind are the essences of our evolutive values. In other words, the love, the wisdom, the discernment, the logic accumulated from all those previous lifetimes is programmed into the subconscious. And I think the memories may be there as well. Although typically we do not remember our previous lives because that would be a horrific distraction against what we're trying to do in this life. And anyway, Billy starts to say things that sound very much like they're coming from previous lives. He says, since ancient times I lived among the stars. And he felt these impulses, and later he would learn that these impulses were from something called the storage banks. In our universe, there is universal storage banks. There are storage banks that are associated to the galaxy, to the solar system, and there are storage banks associated to the planet. So no information is lost, and it's all stored for later times. So the other thing that was very interesting about this is that Billy recognized the light which the stars emitted, but there he also knew that there was an invisible light which he called the love of creation. Sorry about that. I wanted to make sure I was still connected there. I played a little bit of our nature sounds. Anyway, it's been a strange start to the show. Bear with me. Billy's first sighting was pretty strange, and this was, he was with his father. They must have been close to the lock, and for some reason he had an unknown desire to look high above the eastern horizon, and And out of the sky came what he said looked like a gigantic metallic arrow. And it came right towards the 75-foot-meter tall Reformed church steeple where they were at. And it was like a 200-meter disc. And eventually it just left suddenly. Now, Billy, roughly after this time, he started having telepathic contacts from this man named Sloth that I was talking about earlier. Sloth, again, was the extraterrestrial man that healed Billy when he was 6 months old. Well, Billy was told to meet him, and he went out into the forest, and out of the sky came this strange, silvery, pear-shaped craft, which... That was it. The craft landed and it left it shortly thereafter. Well, it was, I think, the following year where Billy again got a telepathic message to go into the forest, and Spoth landed his ship and then stepped just outside the door, and Billy could see the man's face that he had seen in his mind. And Spoth was a very old man, an extraterrestrial man of about 1,000 years old. He had white hair and a white beard and something that looked like almost like a silvery diver suit without the helmet. And Billy remembers being lifted up into the craft as if by ghostly hands, he said. Billy's real name is Edward, which means the guardian of the treasure. And that's because he is the guardian of a teaching that encompasses something like 50 books. So Sloth took Billy up into Earth orbit, and he started to teach him about what his life would be like, and that he would have a difficult life, and that people would turn against him, and that he should focus on his writings, he should not become materialistic, that he should stay in the background, that other people would come forward to tell his story. He was told that people would call him a hoaxer. He was also told that the atomic bombs would be dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And Sloth warned him not to go into the public too much, but to stay in the background, and again, to focus on his writings. One of the things that Sloth told Billy is that in his previous lives on the earth, he had been the people today that we call today Enoch, Elijah, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Emmanuel, and Muhammad. And each one of these people taught an ancient spiritual teaching called the teaching of the spirit, which eventually would kind of be twisted and distorted into the various religions that we have today. And there are interesting reasons why that happened, and hopefully on the show today we'll go into that a little more. One of the things that Sloth told Billy was the biggest problem of Earth humanity is they didn't understand what the creation was anymore. They didn't understand the oneness of creation and the connectedness between all things. And one of the biggest problems here on the earth is our runaway overpopulation, which continues to destroy the plant and animal life on the planet. And because we don't understand the interconnection between all things, we don't understand that not only are we destroying the planet, we're destroying ourselves as well. So Billy met with Sloth for about 11 years, and it was very interesting at times and very difficult at other times. One of the interesting things that Sloth did is put a device on Billy's head that had many, many wires coming out of it, and it gave Billy a tremendous surge of knowledge. And what it really did was open up this storehouse of information in his subconscious from his previous lives. And I just mentioned a few, and the six other prophets besides Edward Albert Meyer. Now, all these individuals shared the same spirit form, and every human being has a spirit form that resides in the center of our middle brain in an area called the superior colliculus, in the area that controls sight, that controls hearing, that controls the integration with your other senses. The spirit form is a fragment of the universal consciousness, and it never dies, and it's never harmed by anything that happens in the material realm. So if you have a nervous breakdown or you go insane, your spirit form is completely intact. It isn't harmed in any way. It never is damaged by anything in the material realm. It will be perfectly sane. It will always be connected to creation. And it's completely neutral, just like creation. The universal intelligence is neutral. It's a neutral, positive, spiritual energy that exists at a higher state than any human being. It could never put itself into a direct communication with a human being in that way. However, your spirit form, in a sense, does have connection. There is something that the spirit form has. It's called a swinging wave, and it comes from what's called the electromagnetic realm of life. And this swinging wave is very powerful. It also has a stabilizing effect to the psyche. So you have what's called a spiritual consciousness, which and your Gemüt is the German word for that which controls the feelings and the thoughts of your spiritual consciousness. You also have a material consciousness. It's who you are in this lifetime. For example, in one of Billy's previous lifetimes, he was a man named Henoch, the material consciousness. But he had the same spiritual consciousness back 8,942 years B.C. Same spiritual consciousness that exists in Edward Albert Meyer today. So you have also a lineage of previous lifetimes associated with your spiritual consciousness. So we live many, many lifetimes. We live 40 to 60 million years in different, completely human, completely physical lifetimes. In fact, our incarnations, our evolution will go beyond the earth. We'll have to leave the earth in order to finish our evolution. Now, I say we, but it'll be a personality of your future self. So you have a family, so to speak, of your previous existences, your previous material lifetimes. And the reason we have all these physical lifetimes is because the purpose of life is the evolution of your consciousness. Now, having said that, let me say this as well, is that in the Meier teaching, it says love and wisdom go together. And the creation and its laws our love and wisdom at the same time. Love continues to be the purpose for existence. Well, you can think of love and wisdom, or the evolution of your consciousness, as kind of two sides of the same coin. One goes hand in hand. Love is considered the highest principle in all creation. And through it, everything exists in absolute logic. And this is one of the creational natural laws. In fact, the love of creation is everywhere, because without it, nothing would be able to exist. So this spiritual intelligence, that I was talking about that's neutral, really. It radiates love. It's a neutral, positive entity. It requires from you self-responsibility and evolution. So you can see where the Meier teaching difference is a very big difference from our religions today. So Billy met with his first extraterrestrial mentor for 11 years. And it was very interesting what he learned, but also very difficult because he kind of became a scapegoat in the village, and his father also punished him particularly severely to the point where he could at times neither sit nor stand. Now, as just kind of a side note, in 1995, the extraterrestrials that I mentioned here, the Pleiaren, they left the Earth. And before that, there had been bases in Asia, North America, and Switzerland. And the base in Switzerland, it was very ancient. It had been here for 300 years, at least, more than 300 years. And during the time period between 1975 and 1986, there were about 2,862 extraterrestrial humans living on the Earth from 12 different races. And they came from the Lyra, the Vega, the Pleiaren systems, and neighboring star systems as well. There were some other interesting bases, one particularly that was in Mount Shasta, which I believe is in Northern California. And it was, the people living there are known as Hyperboreans. Now, this is kind of a tangent, but the Hyperboreans lived on Earth for 100,000+ years. They were here during the time of Atlantis and Lemuria. There was only about 700 of them left. They lived within Mount Shasta, and you could see their golden color spacecraft coming out of the eastern side of the mountain sometimes. And sometimes they would have visitors. They would come right in through the side of the mountain as well. Sometimes they would actually interact with Earth humans, go down in the village that was near the mountain there. They carried beam weapons that sometimes they would use to stun people that did things which were threatening. In any case, this is just one group that was on the Earth for a while. I don't think they're here anymore. There was another group of extraterrestrials called the Hasters, which were fairly close to our evolutionary level. They were brought here. They had a base in the North Atlantic Sea under the waters on the floor of the North Atlantic that was built by the Pleiaren. There are many millions of civilizations in the Milky Way galley, human civilizations. I believe 2,600,000, something like that, in the Milky Way galaxy. That's probably, I shouldn't say many millions. Very, very different varieties of people, some 16 inches tall, some as large as 40 feet tall. The Pleiaren are pretty much, they look like us. They are our size. They were here on the Earth in the ancient past. And that's one of the reasons why they have contact with Billy, is because they're in some ways obligated to try to undo the damage that they did, or certain splinter groups of their own civilizations did to us in the ancient past. In fact, there was one group called the Giza Intelligences that were here until about the late 1970s. And they existed far below the Giza Plateau, far below the Great Pyramid. They influenced people on the Earth from the United States, from Argentina, from South America, and particularly from Germany. And they influenced the people in the Thule Society in Germany. One individual named Eric Janison, whose real name was Hermann Steinschneider, actually also influenced Hitler. So these extraterrestrials had a very negative interaction for a while. They had been here since the fall of Atlantis and Lemuria, and they were interested in controlling the Earth. And one of the things they did was to use religion as a controlling factor, because one of the things they wanted to do was to keep the people of the Earth in the ignorant state that they were in, because 12,000 years ago, there was a great catastrophe on the Earth. In other words, there were two great warring factions, the Atlanteans and the people from Mu. And their war basically just about destroyed the entire Earth. It ended when the people from Lemuria, who their cities, the people from Mu, had been basically destroyed by the Atlanteans, struck back with a meteorite that they guided in with electromagnetic and nuclear propulsion and slammed it into the Earth. Well, this caused the great catastrophe, which just about wiped out all life on the Earth 12,000 years ago. So the Earth humans, Earth civilization, and Earth humanity have been climbing out of the rubble of this great catastrophe, which occurred 12,000 years ago. And these Giza intelligences, they were related to the people that were here during the time of Atlantis and Lemuria, and they posed as gods. They Erisane was the first one of them that went far below the Giza Plateau. And let me hook back up on our Billy Meier overview, and I'll give this in terms of Billy's life and how he first learned about this. After about 11 years of learning from Spoth, one cool evening in Switzerland, Billy was told to climb up a hill near his home in Switzerland, and this is a common hill where he would often meditate and think about things that were happening. And this one evening, he can remember that it was very cool as he was climbing up this hill, and out of the sky came this what kind of looked like a falling star, let's say. And this falling star got closer and closer until finally it did land, and Billy noticed this incredible, or strange, let's say strange, tripod landing gear, and the craft opened up, and Billy crawled in, let's say, and sat down on a bench, on a seat, strapped himself in, and there was a bright flash of light. And Billy was, the craft became invisible. He became invisible, and it floated over to his home, and it hovered over his house in the village that he lived in there near Bullock and Niederflock. And then it took off with great speed, and it rose in height, and Billy mentions that he saw the stars twinkling and shining as he's never seen them before. And he saw a golden-colored disc, which was the sun in the night sky. And when he looked down, he could see the Indian Ocean. Eventually, the craft landed in Jordan. Billy's about, I think at this point, he's probably close to 16 years old. And when the ship landed in Jordan, he felt the heat, and the red rocks, the red sand, And then it wasn't long after that that, again, another falling star, which was actually another spacecraft. It was his second teacher. I believe this was in something like 1953. His second teacher asked it, came down and landed nearby in her gigantic 300-meter disc. It took about a half an hour for her to finally step out of the craft. When he saw her, he was amazed and shocked because he was very certain that he knew her somehow, but he just couldn't sort out his memories or understand how he knew her. She looked like, his words were, a modern angel. She had some very interesting garb on. He left with her in her craft, and they went to Egypt. She landed her ship near the Sphinx, which Billy referred to it as the strange animal human. And this craft was cloaked, so to speak. It was invisible. They both walked outside of her craft, and she gave him a device that made them invisible to the rest of the world, but they were still visible to each other. And Billy played some jokes on some local women there that were congregated in tents, and they were dressing, by the way. It's a strange story. It's the very first contact with Ascot. Ascot would be his extraterrestrial mentor for the next 11 years. What they proceeded in doing is they left this camp and started to travel far below the Giza Plateau, and they traveled in the dark, underground, until they finally came to a great wall, and it looked like they were blocked. And then Ascot, using some technology, took what the contact report calls this giant ashlar, which was a humongous stone, and it just kind of dissolved away. They walked through it, and then it became solid behind them. And at this point, Ascot and Billy see this tremendous hallway, gigantic, with a high ceiling, I suppose. It had to have a high ceiling to a degree. And the light seemed to come from everywhere and yet nowhere. And Billy saw a gigantic ancient spacecraft, along with the smaller ships, strangely dressed guards, and to his right, and on this, for lack of a better word, a plateau, there were certain artifacts that were exact replicas of the crucifixion, the cross of the crucifixion, the crown of thorns, the blood-encrusted nail, and a leather pouch containing precious stones. And now, Billy was shocked by all this. And it was just overwhelming, the implications of everything that he was seeing. And he wasn't even sure how to begin to sort all this out. So Ascot and him traveled back to the surface together, and she started to explain to him that a man named Eris the 11th came to the earth, and this is centuries after the great war between Atlantis and Lemuria. He was the 11th generation removed from Eris the Barbarian, who is the guy that came and conquered Hyperborea, which was in our North Pole, which was a perfect climate at that time. His son, Arian, went down and conquered India. Eventually, the Great War occurred, which wiped out almost the entire Earth. And Eris the 11th is one of these people that came back, you know, centuries after the Great Destruction, and begins this rule. There were these brutal dictators that lived, and this time they were on the surface of the earth. Eris the 11th was murdered by his son Jehovan. Jehovan, at about 3660 BC, ruled the earth. He called himself the creator, and Jehovan, was murdered by his son 340 years after he had taken power. Jehave ruled wickedly again and screamed for blood and revenge and allowed himself to be proclaimed as the creator again of the universe. They were all posing as a god figure. Jehave had three sons, Erisame, Ptah, and Salem. Erisame tried to kill their father, which eventually he succeeded. At first, though, Ptah and Salem drove him off the earth, but he came back. He murdered his father, and he settled down with his army in the land of Egypt in the old cubicle constructions that were some 70,000 years old, which were deep in the interior of the earth, far below the pyramids. And this is where the Giza intelligences created their headquarters, their center for their wicked purposes, where they and their descendants created a deceit, a lying intrigue, wrong teachings, which were designed to lead astray the earth people using religions and cults. Erisame ruled until about 3010 before Christ. Now, here is something very, very controversial. The Meier information says, the next ruler in the leadership of the Giza intelligences was a man named Hen, who was also known as Jehovah, who is the God of the Bible that appears in Genesis 22 when Abraham is ready to sacrifice his son. And this is a place called Jehovah Jireh. And this is where Abraham, he tied Isaac up and was about to place him on an altar and was about to kill him and burn the body. And the burnt offering is very significant because I stumbled across a translator of ancient Hebrew texts called Mara Biglino, and he explains that the burning of the burnt offerings creates a smell that is very similar to what occurs in a spacecraft on longer space flights. And it is his theory that this is why these he doesn't call them the Giza intelligences. He calls them the Elohim, like these burnt offerings. So I don't want to go too far off on the tangent, but it is a very, very interesting. If you get a chance, look up Mauro Biglino. He did 15 or 20 translations for the Vatican. He was their number one Hebrew scholar. And he says the Old Testament does not talk about God. It talks about these Elohim, which is exactly what the Meier material explains. Jehovah, in Contact 2:15 later, would destroy Sodom and Gomorrah with atomic weapons. His disobedience for the population of Sodom and Gomorrah who would not follow his commands was that he let two small atomic bombs be ignited over the cities, which finally leveled to the ground, killing all the humans and the animals. There was also an earthquake at that time and a meteorite that also played a role. The Meier material says that Jehovah was megalomaniacal and the crazy god of the Hebrews. Again, this is extremely controversial. In about 2080 BC, Jehovah, or Hen, was forced out by his nephew, Comagall I. And Comagall I took over the leadership of the Giza intelligences. And eventually, Comegall, the first, was thrown out of power by Comegall the second. And this is where I wish I was a little more organized, but I think it was Comegall the second who, in 1933, started to influence. He had telenotic impulses, which he used to start this movement in 1933, which was related to the Thule Society in Germany, and a kind of a subconscious control of a group of people on the earth. And okay, here, let me read this. This is actually Contact Report 38. And actually, and let me stand corrected, it does say Comegall the First. Now, the implications of that are just astonishing, because Comegall the First came to power in 2080 BC. A lot of these extraterrestrials lived extremely long. It says here, well, let me start a little farther up. This is because they maintain their actual command center there and guide all events from there. That's from below the Giza Plateau. Many kinds of efforts were undertaken to prepare an end for this command center and the driving force of this malicious assembly. Yet that has basically failed up until now, because they have secured everything so much that effective alterations could only be obtained with malicious logical force, which is not allowed to us and all others who are oriented regarding these facts. Comegall the First now selected one of his cousins, and this is what I wanted to get to. And this really implies that Comegall the First lived an extremely long time. Comegall the First now selected one of his cousins as the authority over a group of thousands of individuals who had a quite special mission to fulfill, or would have had. And this mission was essentially based on the telenotic guiding of various groups of humans of aryst descent in certain paths in Germany, America, Argentina, and Brazil, in order that they unconsciously perform help for the plans of Comegall. During this first period, Arusak, therefore Ashtar Sharon, and whatever his other names may yet be, followed these orders unconditionally. So thereby Comegall allocated further great power. But in the course of time, he obtained many kinds of understanding and modified his behavior. So this Ashtar Sharon actually stopped following these Giza intelligences. He actually evolved and stopped behaving this way. Let me continue. Until then, he acted only according to the orders of Comegall. So he only modified his tactic unnoticeably and thereby influenced first his assembly, which he indeed required. By and by, he obtained their trust, and they acknowledged him as their actual leader. So it was an easy game for him to, by and by, include the obtained understanding of the truth and also to behave according to it, even with the knowledge of his assembly. So he started to actually respond to the spiritual teachings and started to straighten out his thinking, this Ashtar Sharon. With their acquiescence, they loosened themselves from the control of Comegall and formed a new splinter group. This happened in the Earth year, 1933. Since then, Arusak followed his mission, imposed by Comegall to a degree, and transmitted his messages to various Earth humans using telepathic impulses. Because, however, he is not yet completely conscious of the truth, in his messages arise contradictions, to which, however, no attention may be given. In various matters of the truth, he is yet inexperienced, so he has to learn first. Nevertheless, his messages in the principal matter are extremely faithful to the truth and stimulate joy. So this Ashtar Sharon, although he started out on this mission with the Giza intelligences to do more mischief on the Earth, to control people through these telenautic impulses, he actually broke away from all this, and he led his group to kind of a positive end, so to speak. If you go forward a little bit, they left, I guess, to some distant galaxy in another dimension where they escaped from Comagol and their influences. Very, very interesting story. The Giza intelligences are part of the information that's talked about in the Meier case. That's extremely controversial. I think one of the things that's interesting about this is if you look at the Ark of the Covenant, I think you can see one of the technologies of these Giza intelligences. And if you think about it, the creator of the universe probably doesn't need any kind of a technology. But this is probably a discussion for another time and perhaps another place. And I may jump out a little early today. Hello, Always Strive. Thanks for coming to the chat room. I'll try to get some shows together this week. I appreciate everyone listening, and I appreciate the people that definitely are listening to these archives. Hope you've enjoyed the show today, and we'll catch you next time. Have a great evening.